I always wanted to do a television show next to the hurricane road, and I finally have a chance. I just realized behind Galvin is a sign that says Hurricane Road. Wow, what a way to start the day. We're in Keene, folks, and if it seems like this blue sky is producing 70 or 80 degrees of temperature, you are in dreamland, because it may be 48 or 49 right now after a cool night in the North Country. This is a place we've wanted to come for a while, and we're finally here, and you are about to meet the most charming people we've ever had on this television camera. Heritage Gallery oil paintings by Bruce Mitchell, watercolors by Annette Mitchell. See how well I read?
Very good. Very good.
Thank you so much for allowing us to come here and see you.
You're most welcome.
You're welcome.
This is going to be a tour. You're going to see some very interesting things. Every time Calvin starts the camera, I got a liberal education, and this will be a great education. I don't know a lot about art, but like most people, I like what I like. And what I've seen inside the doors of your gallery, I like.
Well, thank you very much.
And before we finish, you're going to find out more about these people than you ever dreamed you'd know. Navigator on a KC-135.
Yeah, I'm afraid so.
Do you suppose that one of those junkets I was on to Barksdale or out west somewhere, that you were showing them where to go?
That's possible.
I wonder.
It's possible.
That you were here from what year? 60s?
I was in the service here from, what was it, 60, about 65 to 71.
Could be.
We moved into this house.
I'm going to look at the photographs when I walked up into the cockpit and said, wow, this is fun. I want to see if the guy in there on the maps was...
Never lost, once in a while disoriented.
That sounds like Calvin and me. We're not lost. We just don't know where to turn here. This is going to be such a great time. You stay with us on Hometown Cable. We're going to go inside and we're just going to chat and see what we come up with. Folks, stay with us. Hey, Rochester. I remember that. You are old if you remember that show from Jack Benny days. Well, Jim Rochester, if it weren't for Jim Rochester, we probably wouldn't be here today. But who knows where our lives go when that thing called serendipity begins to kick in.
True.
Well, you went up to see Jim to get some books published, and we're going to talk about those, Bruce, right?
Right.
And that'll be fun. But this view right here... it's just like looking out the window and seeing everything you found delicious about life in these United States.
Well, the interesting thing about it is other people in the past had done them out of the window, looking through the window. This was not the concept that I had. The concept I had here was to tell a story of the North Country. That's what it was. And the way I got the idea was in Vermont. I was driving along a road, and I saw these barns in these windows in this barn, an old barn, and the glass was out of most of them. And I walked up to the man. He was sitting on the porch, and I asked him, I says, would you sell me those windows? And he says, I'm burning that barn down
next year. Are you crazy, young fella?
Yeah.
I'll pay you to take them away.
I thought I was crazy in a way, you know. But I said, I got an idea, and if you'll sell them to me, you can have them. So I went and took the windows out, and I went to the car, and here's my wife, you know, in the car. She says, you're not putting them in the car. Cobwebs.
You're related to Kay, right? You're related to...
So I think I tied them on the roof, on the rack.
You're
and
like,
I went home.
Make you run along
I was
time.
In the service still, and I had a TDY to, I can't remember, I think it was Taiwan, during the Vietnam thing. And I painted a set over there. And brought it home and put it in this window, and then she realized what I wanted to do. And that's how it started. I developed it later into larger windows. This was a small one, and I developed in this, more this size. Actually, they were a little bigger. And took it to Donald Art Company in White Plains. And they didn't know what they
Is
were going to do
they
with
are
it.
Are White Plains? Because I lived in Thornwood right down the road. From
there
you go. Go ahead. Okay, so you took it to them.
I took it to them, and they... they said, I don't know what we're going to do with this. I don't know how I'm going to frame it. And so, but he says, we're going to try it. And so he put it into print, and a company decided they wanted to do something with it. So Mr. Bonas calls me up, and he says, Bruce, I want another set, and I want it last week.
Isn't that always the way?
And before it was all over, I painted one in Goose Bay, Labrador, one at the Alert Barracks at the base, one in Thailand, and one in Spain.
The four sets. Kidding. But you did the one right here in the Alert Barracks?
Yeah, well, I did the first one in Alert Barracks. And then the one in Utapau was set back in a box, the set. And when I got back, there it was, the print. My wife had it on the in the room.
What
there.
A wonderful story.
And then it turns into quite a thing. And that's why I was able to make a living in art.
But it turns into quite a thing is a modest statement that belies the facts. Even though it didn't make you $50 million, I use the word ubiquitous because, you know, it's everywhere. It's Chicken Little, it's everywhere. This has shown up. You cannot turn. I wouldn't be surprised to see it in the illustrated section of the Genuine Bible.
No. Oh, dear. I hope not.
I'm being facetious, but it's
yes,
everywhere. It's been everywhere.
Yeah, a lot of restaurants, a lot of people. Down in the South, they bought a lot of them, in California.
So this thing took on a life of its own.
It took on a life of its own.
You probably did not, even with your great vision, you didn't foresee.
No idea. And, of course, what happened is I could make a living because I had royalties coming in for about 7 years. And so I left the service and moved down to Keene where I loved the Adirondacks, the greatest place in the world.
How can you not? Driving up here today, Calvin and I are oohing and aahing. And this isn't the most beautiful fall we've had in history, but it's still just a beautiful place to take a breath every morning, isn't it?
Prettiest place in the world.
Yeah. So you let's finish the story in a brief form here. This sold as a print, as prints.
Right.
How many copies initially?
Well, the first 3 million basically were sold through the magazines and newspapers.
The first 3 million.
And then Home Interiors picked it up and put it in their line in a frame, and they sold 3 million.
In a frame, folks.
Now, Donald Art Company did Robert Wood, and some of the folks will probably remember him, and the prints that he did. He sold millions of prints.
So many.
But this print that Home Interiors put in their line sold more prints than any of Donald Art's company prints.
Is it still
and he
selling?
Was the largest company in the world.
Still selling?
I don't think so. What happened? Donald Art Company.
Oh, they're not pulling a fast one, are you?
No, I hope not. It was sold twice. He sold it to one of his marketing directors, and he retired. And then the marketing director had it for about 2 years, and then a lady from Florida bought it, Donald Art Company. And I was getting royalties from both of those. And then it went defunct. I don't know what happened. She never let me know. You'd think she would have known, but she didn't.
Well, so you still have the rights.
I always had the rights of the prints, and I have.
So
I have prints.
Start selling it again.
I have prints, and I don't know what they did. The second man promised me the plates, and I never got them. So who knows?
It sounds like something you might want to pursue. After
I tried.
Did you really?
She ended up with the plates, of course.
Yeah.
She bought the and then I tried to find her, and I couldn't find her.
Each one of these is a separate painting.
Yes, they're dropped into a frame. And when they printed this, it cost them $5,000 in those days. This is in the late '60s. It cost them $5,000 to make an engraving. And the reason is they had to photograph the frame, and then they had to photograph each individual painting and drop it into the frame. And an obvious reason, if you try to photograph a frame like this, all the shadows will be different. And what they did, they just highlighted, they just made a light shadow.
Isn't that?
But that was their idea, and they did a good job.
Did you paint each one more than once?
No.
Each picture, you painted each one separately?
Yeah, they were all separate.
But in several different places.
I did, like I say, this set right here was done in Plattsburgh on alert. The guys used
that
to
gives
chuckle.
Me a whole new vision of the alert facility.
Now,
trying to come up with a new.
I don't know how much time you've got, but there's an interesting story about this one.
We got lots of time.
Okay,
tell me, I want it.
This one here was painted in Utapau. Now we had a small room. The co-pilot and navigator usually bunked in this one-inch section, but the AC was a nice guy. A lot of them were very nice to me, and they would give me the better part of the room, and they would sleep in it because they never were in the room hardly. And I was in the other section of the room painting, and I using a magnifying glass looking at the slides.
Yeah.
You know, that I had with me, and they paint these. And this whole set here was painted that way. This was painted in Utapau, Thailand.
That is amazing.
At the base there. Okay.
Talk about not sitting at the base of the dam to paint the picture.
These guys, you know, saw me doing this, and they chuckled. They got a kick out of it. You know, he's not in the, you know, in the officer's club. He's not going downtown. He's not having a ripping. He's either flying, sleeping, eating, or painting, you see. And okay, so we get home. And I got this print when I get home. It's already done because I shipped the paintings back as soon as I got them done. And here, we're over there 2 months. I shipped them at the end of the month. And I come in, and there's the print, and I say, well, we got a flight planning day. A few days later, we get a week off, and then we have a flight planning day. And so I take the print to the deal, and I throw it on the table before flight planning. And the crew looked at it, and they said, oh.
The light went on.
That's what
the
you
light
were doing.
Went on.
I didn't tell them what was going to be done, but there it was.
What a wonderful
the
story.
Print. And I never got a chuckle out of them again. They never laughed at the old man again.
I got to go home and see how many copies of that. I have them because I have old books and magazines, and Galvin doesn't admit that he's as big a pack rat as I am. Isn't that amazing? What a wonderful story.
And that's the print that I threw on the desk.
I'll bet you we get telephone calls and letters when this program gets aired in the North Country saying, I got that in an old, what was it in, it was in how
they're,
many they're, magazines?
They're buying them now in garage sales. I people walk in here all the time. I've had people come in and have me sign it. They buy them in garage sales. Well, you know, 6 million prints. I mean, you know.
It's got to be worth at least a penny a piece. At least a penny a piece.
That's all I got, by the way. My royalty was a penny a piece.
Doesn't matter. We're still laughing, right? We have to have a little humor.
Exactly.
In life. I'm so glad we came up here today. We're going to have so much fun. We're going to talk about books. We're going to talk about paintings and photographs and prints. And maybe we'll even hear from the distaff side of the family over there.
The better
way through. Stay with us. We have so much ground to cover. Every time Calvin shuts it off, we talk for a half an hour and tell so many stories, and then we forget to tell them again on television. Before we get so engrossed in Bruce's background, Annette, I want to find out a little bit about you, because you're not only an artist, but you're a poet. Where are you originally from?
Phoenix, Arizona.
No wonder she shivered when we went out by the sign to start this program today.
That's right.
They don't have goosebumps in Phoenix, Arizona, but boy, we got him here in the Adirondacks. So did Bruce bring you here? Is that how you came here?
Well, I grew up in Salt Lake.
Oh.
And that's where we met and married. He went into the service, and we've kind of traveled all over the country and ended up here in the North Country.
And in many other countries, right?
Well, he did, not me.
Oh, you didn't? You never went?
No.
TDY.
He would go TDY, and I would be here with the family, and that's how it worked.
Now, did you always have an interest in art?
I've always had an interest in art, yes, even when I was a child. I loved art.
You know, I try to instill that love for reading, writing, and drawing pictures or art, because your life is more complete when you can create something, right?
Absolutely. It brings the inner self out into the open.
Oh, I love the way you say it. Way better than the way I say it. But
that's
it's true.
Right. It is
you
true.
You don't know where that inspiration always comes from.
No, you don't.
You're grateful for it.
That's right. You are.
So you drew pictures. Do you have any of the pictures you drew when you were just a very young child?
Oh, I don't. I haven't.
Nobody saved them? My mother saved all that stuff, and I'm so embarrassed.
Well, moving around, you know, you kind of get rid of things because there's a lot of collections that go on, and so you lose some of that.
But
early
you have most
stuff.
Of the artwork you've done since you were an adult, though. Did you ever attend art school?
Oh, yes.
Where did you go?
In the early or the mid 70s, I guess it was. I took classes from Robert Whitney. He was watercolorist up here, mm-hmm. and Mr. Gallucci, and some other artists that I took watercolors from, and I enjoyed it. And so I just kept going.
But where did the poetry start? You're also a poet.
I know, I began to think, and you know, that's dangerous.
Always a problem for me.
When you start thinking. I began to think of some of the things that I was concerned about in life, and especially for little children that they got taught.
Bless you, little one.
Yes, the little ones were important to me, and so I did this little book. And it is Finding a Picture of You. And it is a different kind of a book, because usually a child's book, you read it from cover to cover. This you read from piece to piece, maybe not all at the same time. But you start out with this first little piece and the picture of an owl. And that's the symbol. And the owl is wise, you know, and so he teaches children. And it's about listening. And it's a piece that helps children try to formulate in their minds the importance of listening to different things that are important.
It's got my heart already, but that's so important in this day and age especially.
It is, really. And then you go on to butterflies and families and how wonderful they are. They're all different in a family. The butterflies are all different, colorful, and beautiful, and so is every child in a family. They're different. Some can paint really well, and others do sports really well, but they're all important, no matter if they're older or younger in a family. So I thought that was good, and I go on to open the door to many different subjects. This is about taking care of pets and loving your pets and being responsible.
So you did the poetry and the
pictures,
the
right?
Oh.
And of course, our children don't fight and quarrel
anymore.
So if there's a little piece, and I use this as a symbol, and it kind of tells the story, doesn't it?
It sure does.
So it brings the subject up, and the parents can sit down and talk with the child. And
you always sign it A.M.?
On the pictures I did, but not on the poetry.
How about your other paintings? Do you?
Sometimes I sign the whole name, and sometimes I don't. I'm variable there.
I like that. I'm pretty variable myself.
And this one is...
Oh, I like that. Oh, look at this.
This is on gratitude, and see the symbol of it?
Oh,
with these little birds with their mouths wide open. What do mothers do for their children? They see to it that they're fed and they're clothed and they're taken care of. And this connotes gratitude, and we want our children to be grateful. If they're grateful, they're more, they listen better, don't they?
Don't you want this woman to teach your Sunday school class, huh? Or to talk to your kindergartners? Oh, look at this.
And
oh,
this,
my goodness.
This shows the environment, how we can take care of the environment. It's important, and so are our bodies are important, and we don't put in our bodies those things that might spoil the environment of our bodies as well. So I touched on that, and that's something that people can...
What a neat book. Chocolate zucchini cake!
That's right!
I'm in heaven!
So you even get a recipe with this.
Oh,
and a little game also comes in it later on. But the children here, see, they clean the house and they do their chores, and so the mother has time to spend with them in playing. And so what they wanted to do is to bake a cake. All children love to get in the kitchen and bake. And so this mother gets out her recipe and they bake this wonderful chocolate zucchini cake.
Yep, you got you got me where you want me.
It's a lot of fun. And here, this is something for you. It's a grandfather's legacy. And see this tree?
Yep.
It's a 1,400-year-old living oak that I found a picture of.
I'm almost there.
It represents a grandfather, and the grandfather has a conversation with his grandson, and they discuss certain important things in his life, and he explains it to the grandson, and the grandson says, "I want to be just like you." And then it goes on to say that he will represent, do what the grandfather did.
That's your legacy, right?
And that's the legacy, and then he'll pass it on to his children as
absolutely
well.
Absolutely beautiful concept with the tree.
Right.
I'm not quite that gnarled, but I'm getting I'm getting there. I really like it. I love what you do. Look at this blue jay.
See, this is about working, the work ethic. We want our children to learn how to work. These are behaviors that are character-developing behaviors, and that was the idea for the book in the first place. To help children, they go to school, they learn many wonderful things to help them in their lives, but some of the character-developing things get overlooked. So a parent in a home can take a little tool like this, sit down and discuss these different things with the child, and it helps them. It focuses it for them in their minds. And it's a fun thinking book. It's something that they can, you know, see the pictures
wow.
and hear the rhyming
wow.
words.
Look at this picture. Look.
Yeah, that's.
Look at this picture.
That's a little.
And a butterfly.
I have all these.
All you
pictures.
Lack is a dragonfly in there.
Yeah, I don't have a dragonfly.
Oh, you got it. Have you ever painted a dragonfly?
No, I haven't.
You? Come on.
Nope.
Okay, I'll give you. A photograph I took of a dragonfly in my front yard, and you guys can paint a picture.
They're beautiful.
Don't forget. I promise you, I'll find it.
And this is on goals. We want our children to set goals.
That's a great picture.
Yeah. It's a little conversation between a butterfly and a turtle.
Native Americans would love that, you know.
Oh,
that's
yes.
Beautiful, yeah.
And then a chipmunk learns not to destroy property. And so he's here busy destroying this little flower. And it tells a story here. Each piece is a little story. And here is a picture of fish.
The fish tail.
All children love fish. But all these fish are different. And it represents society. Everybody's different in society. We all have different talents. There's different colors in society. There's different cultures in society. But we need to respect them all. And this is what this little piece represents. And it's all about being kind and understanding to other people.
Kindness is a gift to friends and will return to us. Our hope depends on
yes,
it.
Exactly. That's it.
When did you do this?
I did this. It took me a year to do this little book. And then I printed it and found that I hadn't completed the process of my work. And so I saw things in it that I could have done better. So
oh,
I went back to Jim.
Oh, come on.
I went back to Jim and I said, I have to do this again. It's got to be right.
So he took a deep breath and said,
so he
okay,
did.
Annette.
Yes, he did exactly that. And he reprinted it. And I'm pleased with the finished product now. I can relax that I've done my best.
Another Border Press, Annette Mitchell
well,
collaboration.
See, I went to Jim first on this other little book. It was a family book for my children to learn something about their mother and their grandchildren.
Aren't those great? They're wonderful.
Yes. And so then this I got this idea for the second little book. And
better get it in every library.
I'm trying to. That's
class.
What I'm trying to do now.
I'll help you.
Is
Let's
get
go.
Them all around so that people can use this as in their families for benefiting.
Very. I was as you were talking. Of course, I was mesmerized. But I was reading the poetry
yes.
as you turned the pages, and you, very very insightful person. I don't know if that's built in or if you've developed that over the years. But
who knows. I think it started long before we came here.
I was hanging around Bruce.
Oh, really? Okay, we'll give Bruce the full credit for that.
Well,
no,
I don't
but
know.
You know where, like I said before, where that insight, where that creativity comes from, and then to be able to put it in a form like that, which is beautiful for people of all ages. But we're all children.
Living life.
Living life. Paying attention, and as you said,
observing.
In there, listening.
Well, observing.
Listen. To have six children.
Six children and 18 grandchildren, it kind of gets you thinking about what's important in behavior.
We were comparing the numbers this morning. You got two more to go to catch our 20, so get to work, will you? Call those kids up on the phone the minute we finish here. But that's beautiful.
Right.
Family is what it's all about, and these little family books and future generations are so beautiful. It's something we've talked about so many times, the oral history, and then write it down.
Right.
I'm just reading a book of my wife's family, the Vaughn family, that was written by hand by a man named Nathan Vaughn in the mid-1800s and was finally published in hardbook form, skinny like that one, in 1905. But it's wonderful to go back and read how they participated in the Battle of Plattsburgh.
Well, yes, and you know, when I'm long gone, this little book will be here for my family to know what was grandmother like. And they can pull this out.
Just watch the video and they'll find out what she was.
They can watch this video, it's right.
That's great. So you paint every day?
Not every day, but I do volunteer work and other things in our church. So I spread myself around in my activities. But I love to paint and I love to write, so I keep that active in my life. I try to keep up on that.
Have you got another book of poetry ready to go?
Not yet.
Come on.
I've got two poems of the Adirondacks in Bruce's book.
That's as it should be, right? Just dole them out two at a time, right?
Tells also about family, and it tells about the beauty of this area and what it means to us to live up here.
Well, it's great to appreciate this place and then to express it in a way that other people can know how you appreciate it. That's wonderful. See?
Thank you.
And she didn't know she could talk. Bruce, I'm coming over to say hello to you again. You were chuckling a lot in the background. She always told the truth, didn't she? Everything she said was absolutely
true. It was wonderful.
Yeah. So you people have been together through thick and thin for many, many years, traveled all over the country. But where did your interest in the arts begin? You're a navigator in a KC-135.
It became really a focus point for me in high school. I had a teacher that was very good, and I learned...
Let me get over on this side here.
I learned...
I don't have a good side, but you do. Okay, high school teachers.
Yeah, Marjorie Main was her name. I can't believe I remember the name. She taught architecture and also drawing and other things, and I the perspective... I learned from her, and the seriousness of trying to make something look like it is. I think that's what I learned from her, and I guess you'd call me a traditional artist, bordering on realism.
I love it.
But I that's where I really got interested. Then I went to college and went into art, majored in art.
Where?
At University of Utah, and I. It was during the Korean conflict, and I ended up A1, and I decided, well, I think I'm going to be an ROTC student. I wanted to fly in the air instead of be on the ground, and that's what happened. And I went and majored in art and minored in ROTC.
Became and had a lot of time to do drawing and painting.
Oh yeah, because
do you
well,
do a lot
I'm
of
major.
Line art, or is it all oils, or you do
I do.
A lot of watercolors?
I used to go to malls. When the kids started going to college, admissions, things like that, I had to have some extra money. So I went to malls down south and did quite well in some of them. And I did pen and inks in malls.
I
like to do it. I like to do it. And
I'm glad he said that.
I do remarks with my prints. They're in the other room there. And I love to do them. It's kind of a nice diversion from the oils.
Explain to people what a remark is.
Well, it's interesting because very few people know what a remark is that come in the gallery. Rembrandt did them, which is interesting. He'd do an etching, and then he'd put a little sketch down at the bottom of the etching and then sign it again. And that's remarking. You're putting a sketch with a print. And of course, his prints were etchings, and ours are reproductions of our work.
And yours are worth quite as much as his are.
But, no, I
but
don't.
Then you're not as old as Rembrandt is.
No, I'm not. A few centuries. But the interesting thing is, of course, that he did it, and people still don't, you know, recognize. If down south in the big cities, they have the big shops where the big name artists put the remarks on
Rembrandt,
them all the time.
Rembrandt, you talk about seeing the beauty in things. I was just exchanging one of my many emails and letters with people, and we were discussing one of Rembrandt's paintings, I believe, from 1655. The subject was a side of beef, and it's called the something ox or the.
I know what you. Yeah. Which one you're talking about?
And the beef carcass or something, yeah, is the original title, and you know who would ever guess that a man would become famous for sketching a side of beef.
Well, I think he became more famous by painting portraits.
I think maybe you're right, but that's a painting that you knew about.
I knew about it, yeah.
Isn't that interesting?
But the portraits are
so you painted a lot when you were in the service, and now, you know, Annette says she writes and paints when she's inspired and does a lot of church work. Do you paint every day, or do you?
Most every day I have in the last 35 years, pretty much so. Sometimes longer, of course, but well, like yesterday, I went out selling the book. That happens too.
It was on the road as we're recording this. What the heck date is this? The 21st?
Yeah.
21st of September. He headed down into some of my old stamping grounds: Route 8, Speculator, Poland,
exactly,
Newport, Podunk. Knocking on doors, trying to sell a few books.
That's right.
Now, yeah. What you showed me a book over here that I want to see a little more of. You can tell us a little bit about Vermont Trails, because that's not something you just completed this week.
No, this is a story.
Take a look at this, folks. Can this you see over his shoulder?
This is a book that I did for First Vermont Bank. It's a series of paintings based on the First of Vermont.
What year?
It was done. I painted it in 74 and 75, and that's about all I painted was for them. I think I painted three paintings for the gallery in 2 years.
No kidding.
That's the truth. These were fairly difficult paintings. There's town scenes and so forth, and it was interesting. The president of the bank saw my things in the place in Lake Placid, came to the gallery, took the window print down to his marking director. The marking director came up with the idea of First of Vermont. And the marking director came to the gallery, got some of my paintings, took them to Robert Vos of Vos Galleries in Boston. They said, to make it short, he says, can this man do what we want? And they wanted a series of the First in Vermont. I didn't know anything about this except for the fact I let him take the paintings. He came back, he said, Bruce, I think we're going to commission you to do the series. They were thinking at first of maybe having quite a few artists do it, but they decided they'd have me do it. But it wasn't definite, and they had me paint the Capitol building. Let me see if I can find the other one real quick. I don't know if I can find it quick. Maybe it's the second one. Yeah, it is. The first two I did, and the Granite Quarry in Vermont. And we took them down to Vos. I'm going to try to make this quick.
Why?
But it was because it's interesting. Oh, you know what? We don't have to make it quick.
Take your time.
Okay. Well, we took the two down to Vos, and this is an interesting story to me. And he has this interesting room in his gallery. It's all black with two black easels, and he has the lighting perfect, and he takes these two paintings, he puts them on the easels, and we're looking at them, and the bank president says, Bruce, you know, how long did it take you to do that painting of the Capitol building? And by the way, people have seen this on TV many times behind the governor.
Oh yes.
Well, actually, wait a minute, I did a second one for them. I don't do that very often, but the First Vermont Bank painted, had me do a second one for the state. And that's how that ended up there. So the first one, the First Vermont, as far as I know, the bank still has the first one. But anyway, the bank president says, Bruce, how long did it take you to do that? And I says, well, it was about 2 weeks. And Robert Vos said immediately, and Bruce, how long have you been painting? Don't you ever answer that question. And he said it just like that. He was very emphatic. Don't you ever answer that question without telling people how long you've been painting. Because
of course. How long did it take you to change my spark plugs, right?
Or
how
long did it... 2 weeks don't mean anything.
No.
It's experience. And so I've never forgotten that. I have people ask me that question all the time, and that's, of course, that's the way I answer.
I love it.
Because Robert Bose told me that.
Yeah, he's the man.
But anyway, this is a series of different paintings of... This was one of the difficult ones.
It's hard to see, but
it's pretty small.
Yeah.
One of the things they did, they left the frames on them, and it made the pictures a bit smaller. That was the marketing director's line. He wanted something different. I can't complain for wanting something different. Here's the
first electric motor.
Robert. I don't have my glasses on.
Thomas Davenport?
Yeah.
You're moving it. It's a Brandon blacksmith named Thomas Davenport.
He made the first electric motor. General Electric.
Who would have known?
He died a pauper in General Electric.
We better tell our friends who are doing that calendar over there in Vermont.
Snowflake Bentley.
Oh, this is great stuff. But 32 years ago.
Yeah.
And your artwork today is...
This is the new one.
Here. This is a new...
You want to get off of that one.
I'll hold the mic, you hold the book. This is
the important one.
We'll talk about it.
Well, that's important, too. The Adirondacks has...
That was not for sale anymore, by the way. We're trying to convince Bruce to get it republished.
I don't know if we can.
It ought to be, because it's great.
But anyway, this is the new book we just did, and I wanted this for the 4th of July for obvious reasons, so I could get it on the market in the summer. But we didn't make it. The man's getting old, you know. He's getting older, and he wants to get it. But anyway, I got it about 2 weeks ago. And so I've sold, went on 3 selling trips. But anyway,
was telling me how hard Jim worked on this to make sure that it would be right for you.
Jim was golden.
He's quite a guy, isn't he?
And then I went up there one day, and we went over it again. He has to put them on a disc, of course, the new way of printing.
We did a TV interview with him up there, and he's just such an interesting guy and great history.
He does great.
Yeah.
Anyway, the book has paintings by me and then 2 poems by my wife. She, basically what she did, she took my thoughts and put them in her words. She did a fantastic job. I can't write.
You're partners.
I can't.
This
I can't.
This is the way it works when you're partners.
I can't write my way out of a paper bag. I mean, you know. She did a fantastic.
You have a way of expressing yourself here that nobody else has that I've seen in a long time. These are beautiful Adirondack views.
I decided to open it with pictures rather than the forward and the front and the title. And
she's helping you so the camera can see.
My favorite lake, the Upper Aussable.
Oh, yeah.
And I've seen a lot of lakes in the world, and that's my favorite. My favorite view, the view from Hopkins. And actually, this is from Spread Eagle, but I borrowed a section of Hopkins because there's this gully here.
Poetic license. You can put anything you want in there.
And in the scene, this is trees, and you don't see these mountains right here. So I painted these mountains right here.
It's another
from
part
Hopkins.
Of your license. You can do that.
And it's Spread Eagle. And as I got this thing on the canvas, I says, this is from Spread Eagle. Gotta have a Spread Eagle.
Isn't that the way it is? Do you you take a lot of photographs? Do you work from photographs or from memory?
Because it takes me, that painting took about two weeks to paint, maybe 3 weeks. And I'm not going to be up in that wind for 3 weeks.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
This is from this scene here down at the bottom, probably in the TV. It's pretty small, but it's from Pyramid. This used to be my favorite. It's my second favorite now. And then this is the new inlet haystack.
How many pictures in the book?
I think there's 46. You know, I've forgotten. The gray hair takes it away, the memory, you know.
Once it's done, it's done, right?
But I'll count them again, and then I'll know next time. Haystack, some people's favorite.
Yeah.
And that's, of course, Whiteface from the river. And Jay, I had to have. You know, I had to have the bridge in Jay, even if it's not there right now.
Come on, we want it. We want it back.
It's going to be back.
I got video.
It'll be brand new, though.
Yeah, I know.
It's brand new. You know, but the same design. Blackbrook, which is right near Jay, and actually it's near the town of Blackbrook. But I like the stream because it's very interesting. Haystack with a Downy. I'm doing a series of paintings for a collector of mine of the birds of the Adirondacks.
Are you really?
Yeah. And he's got...
Audubon reincarnated.
He's got a few of them. He's got a few of them.
That's
I'm not sure how many, so I better not say. I think it's 25 or 30.
Oh, my.
This bridge in Keene Valley.
Let's move under that light.
Under this light, yeah.
Yeah.
Because here we are with the... Here we are with the picture
here. We should have done this a lot sooner.
Yes, here's the picture.
There's the big picture.
One. Yeah, there's the big one.
There's that big one.
The one I talked about.
Is that better, Cal?
Yeah, I'm getting some glare, but at least we can see it.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah. And these are great. My wife decided she liked this. She got this for Christmas last year. That's on the Trail to Baker near Saranac Lake. Yeah. And then I put the little deer in there. This is on the trail to Spread Eagle, and just love that whole thing. This has been a very popular print in the gallery.
Has it really?
Yeah. Saranac Lake up here. Trailed by a stream going into the Boquette River, which is a very favorite river. I get a lot of my ideas by hiking the rivers and the streams.
How can you help it?
Oh, man.
Yeah, I love it.
I mean, and my favorite is in here also, the opalescent. This is a trail to the lower Aussable Lake. This is a barn in Keene, and it's a backside.
Barns are great, aren't they?
Yeah, oh man.
What would you do without those windows from the old barn, right?
And this is a...
That's a great story. Can I buy your windows? Take them. I'm going to tear that thing down anyway.
I gave him a couple of bucks, by the way. I didn't know I have any idea what it was going to be.
He's still around. He's going to come back and get you after this. I love it.
But this is Cascade.
Oh, yeah.
And with Algonquin. I mean, I had to have something like that in there. Road down in Keene. The old great horned owl, another one of my collector's birds, and I thought this would go great with Colden because it's got kind of a bump on the end. And this is Noon Mart down in Keene Valley, of course, Mark's Noon.
Yeah.
And this is Woods down by Elk Lake. I've done about five of this type of thing. I like them. I ought to do more, but. I don't know. You so many things you like to do.
Makes you feel good.
You know?
Do it.
Yeah. There's a camp. One of my favorite commissions was this camp I did for a lady along Hurricane Road here. They have this camp, and it's a family that's had me do things over the years.
Yeah.
And I did a camp. This was one of the best-selling prints in the gallery, the one up here, the road to Rock Harbor, north of Westport, between Essex and Westport. And I got that view. I was headed to do a commission for a man, get the pictures for a commission I was doing for him. And that morning, I drove up, and there was that. There's a pond right in here, and the depth.
And you just, can see it. They can see
man,
a little mist coming
out. That was one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Down below, Marcy.
Yep.
And this kind of an abstract in a way. You know, Andrew Wyeth, you know.
Oh, yeah.
I saw a quote from him. In Life magazine, when they had a series of his paintings in there years ago, and one of his statements was, "We realists have to be more abstract."
I love it.
Than the abstract artist.
Isn't it interesting though?
But it was an interesting quote.
Think
I never
it.
Forgot. He had and it, over the top over the top
it.
Of this picture, he had this house, and it was enormous on this one side to balance the painting. He had these rocks, small rocks down there, and a small tree on the other side of the painting. Here's this big, long painting. He has this big house, rocks, and it balanced it.
And it was perfect. Yeah.
Real quick. Well, I could show it here. Gully. Mammoth rocks coming down. What am I going to balance that with?
The bird.
No, this is what balanced it.
Yeah.
The bird helped, but this.
Yeah.
They lit up rock with the dark shadows.
People don't think about that. Like I said, I like what I like.
Yeah.
And then you can tell them why they like it. I'll tell you why I like it, because I balanced it with the... I love it.
That's this small one up here. It's hard to see, I'm sure. But it's Colvin, one of my other favorite views. And it's got the lower...
He's like, I mean, you have 400 million favorites.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I got about four. In the book, it talks about that. It's kind of interesting, the forward. The lower lake and the upper Aussable Lake. And this is Wolf Jaws from the Aussable. This is another river I've hiked twice, actually. This is the view from...
Wow.
Up here is the view from Marcy at sunrise. Boys, my boy, two boys of mine, with flashlights, went to a lean-to, and we slept over till 3:30 in the morning, hiked to the top of the mountain, hoping that it wasn't fogged in, and this is what we saw.
Oh, boy.
It was...
Ask me if it was worth it, right?
Yeah. Was it worth it?
Oh, boy.
And this is, of course, Whiteface from the end of the gondola, not the top, but the end of the gondola. This one I did for the book because I wanted horses in it. I love
horses.
You've
got to tell Jim Rochester for me that he did a super job. Isn't this incredible?
He did. He did a fantastic job.
This is local, guys, folks.
Unbelievable.
This isn't Chicago, you know?
No, no. And he did such a nice job for Annette that I thought, well, I'm going to do it then, too. I mean, I could have gone south and got, you know, the big fancy places to do it, but I like Jim. Yeah. He's a good guy.
Oh, this is great.
And, of course, the Westport train station is the prettiest train station in the world.
Yeah, you've got the painting in the other room, too.
I don't know. I
right?
don't. This one's a collector's, but I have the print somewhere. In the Yeah, there's the print right there.
I saw the print somewhere.
Yeah, there, it's right over there. The
there's
original is owned by my
there's
collector.
There's one on his easel right now that he's just finished.
That's also for him.
Oh, there it is down there in the corner. The yeah, I knew I saw it. Yeah, okay. I just didn't want people to think I was
I just finished another one for the same collector of the Port Henry.
Did you really?
Yeah, it's on the other side.
On the easel.
We love trains. I mean, Calvin and I love trains. Big ones, little ones, old train stations. Yeah, we visited a few.
And this is, of course, loons.
Oh, yeah.
That's one of my favorite birds. Let's face it. So do.
Ask me about that when the camera's
and
off.
The old rack and
it's magical for me. If I can hear a loon, I know I'm okay.
There you go.
If I walk in a store and they got one of those stupid little tapes playing somewhere, I'll stop and turn my camera on and record the whole thing. And my wife say, "Are you crazy?" I said, "Listen to this on the way home in the plane. There's a loon playing in our ear."
There you are.
I love it.
And this is my favorite river. The opalescent. Now this one is truly an artist's liberty a little bit. I've done the flume. It's a famous flume that in the Metropolitan there's a painting by Innes, that's the first time I saw it. And the flume is right around this corner here a little ways. And so I painted it two seasons. But I decided that there was other things on the Blessed that I loved. This is just past the flume. This is about 1,000 yards down the river. This is another $1,000.
Put it together, what do you get?
1,000 feet down the, yards down the river. And I put them in made
perfect.
It in together.
Perfect.
Yeah, I thought the composition worked
exactly.
out. This is the Racket River, sunset on the Racket. Avalanche Lake, which is, you know, a great lake because of the, you know, the big cliffs. This is an interesting road to Mount Defiance because, you know, that's why they couldn't hold Ticonderoga.
You got it.
You go out to the end of this road and there's Ticonderoga right down there.
Way down.
And that was a road to it. I've done Ticonderoga from that mountain. Another gentleman has it and I didn't have a slide of it, so I didn't have that put in the book. Another road. This is on Jim Poulter's
land. Make sure you turn it enough for Calvin to see with the camera there.
Yep. He bought a couple of paintings of mine, he took me on his land.
Oh.
And I just went out of my cookie. That's what I call it when I like something. You know, I go out of my cookie
when I see it.
And
the blue heron.
The blue heron down in Keene Valley. Which we do have them.
Oh, we got them. I have three right behind my house. They fly by me every morning and night.
This is from Hurricane, only appropriate. We got the road right here, and then Hurricane's just down a ways. Elk Lake. I still have this painting. These two are still in the gallery. This one's a large painting in the gallery. Elk Lake. This, another, I took all the wood out of here. Forever Wild, of course, they leave the wood in there.
Yeah.
And just as I was taking the pictures for this view, guess what came through?
Is it that something?
A canoe.
It's a perfect.
It was planned.
I don't know if you're going to have time. If we go into the gallery, you can shoot the big ones in there. Saranac Lake with a canoe. I had to have a canoe in it.
Canoes are great.
Yeah. This is my favorite little hike in the Adirondacks. Joe. I painted this from the road, and I call it, and you see Joe in the foreground of the big mountains, and I painted that twice, winter and fall, I think it was, and I call it Joe and His Friends, or something like that. Chapel Pond.
Yep.
The inlet to Chapel Pond. This here is Wallensburg Farm. I had to put a farm in the Adirondack, a couple of them. The birdhouse is still there. The barn is falling. Little historical painting here. We won't have the barn
too much. It's there forever now.
Up here at McCann, one of my favorite farms in all the... It's up farther north. I've painted this about three or four times. And I just love it for some reason. It's a composition.
Yeah.
And
it is. It's really great.
The Colden from Colden. And this was kind of done for the cloud, stormy cloud, which is typical in the Adirondacks. And white face in the winter. Grandchildren. I'm trying to let people know I do little humanistic things of kids, you know. I've done a few commissions with kids. I did one of four children playing tag with white face in the background on the field. And the parents, they way down by New York City, they came in the gallery and heard that I'd done things like that, and they had me do it. I had a time getting shots of those kids playing tag.
I bet you did.
I had to individually shoot them and put them together. It was amazing.
I said it's all right for you to do
it's
that.
It's all right, you know. It's
and
all
then
right.
The poems.
And then the poems.
Adirondack Retreat. Yep.
And here mentions the fact that one of our granddaughters was named Marcy after the mountain.
Gee whiz.
That was kind of...
Gee whiz.
The young lady was from Saranac Lake, and my son was from here, and, you know. And then this one, the Adirondacks, as we see. She did a fantastic job. You can tell that it was kind of my thoughts, but she put them the way it ought to be.
Yeah.
You know,
It's not your name on it.
It's her words.
What a nice book.
And this is the Gothics with the eagle, and Saranac Lake again with some ducks.
Yeah.
And on the back is another one of my wife's paintings. It's probably one of my favorites.
Tip it a little bit.
Hockey on a field.
Oh, isn't that great?
Hockey
Such memories,
field.
Huh? Such sunset. Memories.
Yeah. And another road. Another commission deal. Rosendahl, I think it is his name. Or Rosenberg. I can't remember. The industrialist that turned artist when he retired. He came up here, bought this camp, which is down at the end of this road. And these people that bought that from him and his family wanted me to do a painting of the view from the camp. And on that morning, to go down there and take the pictures, the old man saw that. And I, again, went out of my cookie.
Yeah, isn't it neat?
And so I ended the two in the book with those two.
What a great book. I love the book. We got to take a look around this gallery, okay? Let's do it.
Oh, wait a minute. Go ahead.
Yeah, we're on. Go ahead.
I'm going to sit down.
This is beautiful. What do we got here? What are you making?
This is
the
Port Henry train station. And my collector found out that he wanted to have that done. And I've done four train stations for him. I do series for this man in seasons. I should have asked him if I could use his name. I don't want to use his name today because I didn't get his permission. But anyway, he has quite a few of my paintings. And he wanted me to do, for the fourth scene, Port Henry. I had done Westport twice, Port Kent once, and then he wanted me to do this.
That is just...
And he hasn't even seen this yet. I just finished it.
Can you actually see movement in the smoke coming out? I can. Now, I want folks, this is a complete aside, but I want people to look at this remote. This is like a gaudy little remote. We could hang this in the wall and sell this for $550.
That's my abstract.
Look at.
Well, you know, I thought about selling some of my palettes.
Look at this place. You think he gets mad once in a while and goes, I love it. Look at this.
No, I don't
place.
Get mad. I just grabbed my bra. I grabbed
this.
This. Yeah, this is a masterpiece.
Rembrandt would love this table.
I mean, I've thought about, you know, an abstract. I sell that for $10,000, right?
Start at $10,000. Start the auction at $10,000. That's beautiful.
I even got notes on it for me. This man wants a commission.
Look at this. Look at the sticky notes.
Yeah,
I think we're related.
I think
we're related.
If I didn't have this, I'd be lost. The gray hair, man.
This is great. How close is this finished?
That's done, right? I blend it. It's pretty well dry, and I gotta frame it.
Now, when you finish painting it, do you put a cover? What do you do? Just as it is. You don't believe in it?
I always never believed in it, and then I read a book once on art, and it was a dictionary type thing, and you go through it, and it explains putting varnish on painting.
Yeah.
And galleries do it, and mainly museums do it, and the reason they do it is so that when people touch it, they don't ruin the paint. But the problem is, in time, they crack, and that's what the dictionary said. Is if you're selling to a collector that's just going to put it in their home, wise not to paint varnish it.
Very smart.
Because that varnish will
that
crack.
Way.
It will crack. And I always thought that in my head, because you go into a museum, they're all cracked.
Yeah, we're good.
Seriously.
No, I agree with you.
And they have to take all that varnish off and then put it back on.
Well, it's hard to conserve
home,
paintings, isn't it?
In a home. And we got a little lesson going here. In the home, what you do, if they get a little dirty, you take a good artist's linseed oil, not ordinary linseed oil, artist linseed oil, put it on the canvas and wipe it off. And it'll bring back the color and snap the painting back. Now, if it's really dirty, then it needs to be cleaned. And what you clean it with is ivory snow. That's what the professionals use.
Come on. We gotta tell Ken Ray, don't we?
I hate to advertise ivory snow, but that's the way it goes. That's what they use. Ivory snow soap. The dishwater soap.
I would love it.
And they put it on and wipe it, and it's a mild soap, and it takes the dirt off, and then rinse it oil. That's if it's in real bad shape. But usually, I have never done it that way, because I've got a painting upstairs that I've had for 50 years that I did, about 50 years, let's see, 40, yeah, it's pretty close to 50 years. And I linseed oiled it, and it took, you'd be surprised the dirt that came off.
Just wipe it off.
Or to just put it all over it, and then wipe it off till it's all gone, it'll come off. That's a good lesson for anybody that owes oil.
All right, let's move along. We want to see what else we have around here. Remember the old days when they called it bundling and people weren't really married? They only had one bed and they had a big board in the middle so they couldn't. Well, that's the way the gallery is, and this is Bruce's side, and that's Annette's side. I wouldn't be surprised if they don't step over the line every now and then. So this is your side. Now, I want to talk about etchings. We haven't even mentioned that yet.
It's what kind of interesting. I did etchings years ago. I guess it's been 15 years ago. Long time ago. And the first years that I had them, for about 4 or 5 years, I sold about 50 a year. And then it started dwindling. And I wondered what the deal was, you know. And it turns out that people like color.
Isn't that amazing?
And people are doing etchings now. They watercolor.
Yeah.
And I kind of didn't want to go into that. I like oils. And it was kind of an interesting thing for me to do. I loved to do it in college. And so I did quite a few. I did about 19 of them.
Did you really? Are they all here?
No, they aren't.
Oh. Those are beautiful.
Over the years, I had them all, and they've sold about 2 a year.
At that rate, you have to live to be 100.
I haven't framed any for a while, and so I've only got three left. Wait a minute, I got one over there. I got four left
love
now framed.
I love them. You know,
some people do, and that's all they buy.
When people put photographers onto their computers, there's one little element that says sepia, and you can change to get this reddish tone.
Yeah.
People do that on purpose, Bruce.
Oh, yeah.
So maybe. Who knows what will happen?
If I get the time, I the collectors, commissions that kind of, you know, on things for the gallery, I have to keep going. I got away from it. I love it, though. It's fun. I used to, keep the print, the paper in the, as you're getting ready for the press in the bathtub upstairs, and then I had to press in the room.
I love it. There's a whole process we'll get into sometime. What else?
Pen and inks.
Oh, yes, I love it.
I used to do them.
Very special to me, because I do a lot of pen and ink drawing, not nearly this good.
I don't know if it'll do better or not.
Oh, look at this.
This year, I've sold a fair amount of the pen and inks, and I'm down to four. I guess I ought to do some more. But I like to do them.
You can do those in bed at night,
but
goodness
sake. I think I was telling you before, I don't think we told it on camera, but what I'm doing now is remarks.
Yeah.
And that's similar. Of course, it's obviously similar. You're doing it in pencil rather than ink. And so I do quite a bit of this. And
you can see the remarks at the end.
And
the bottom.
What I do, I listen to TV and do my little remarks. And it's a break from the pen.
Have you always done them?
My collector, my large collector that I have now, the one at the train station, he was trying to talk me into it for about 3 years. He's gonna like to see this. He's been an instigator of a lot of things for him.
Yeah.
Anyway, he was trying to talk me into doing remarks, and I didn't like remarks, because I'll tell you why I didn't like them. A remark normally is done so that you only have a remark in one corner, and the mat goes up
right,
and it comes over.
Right.
You've seen it.
Right, lots of them.
Okay. I never liked that. And I thought, you know, and he kept telling me, you know, this guy, kept telling me.
This is wonderful.
Let's do this.
This is absolutely a wonderful idea.
And so I decided, well, I'll do it. And so I went all the way across.
So you do them all the time now, or?
Yeah.
Yeah. Just fabulous.
This wall is that, and I have a few walls.
Well, just show us what you think might be significant that you'd think our viewers might want to see.
Just extra prints, like in the other room, and I know he's been photographing the other room. And then my daughter has a few things here.
How many kids do you have?
Six children. Six. My daughter's the artist, and she needs to get some more in here.
What's her name?
Actually, she's the only other artist I have in here.
What's her name?
Lori Hall.
Oh.
And, I can't pull that back over too far, can I? Maybe you can see it. But anyway, we own the original of this one. I love that thing.
Oh, yeah.
And, anyway, I've got to get more in here. We've sold some of them this year.
And where does she live now?
She lives up in Bloomingdale.
So she paints nearby.
Does
she have her own gallery?
She paints with color. You can see Rider colors and wildlife with the Adirondacks. Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
She learned well.
She does acrylics.
Does she
do? Bruce does oils, and I do watercolors, so we don't get into each other.
You compliment each other.
Yeah, there you go.
Leave my paints alone.
The old bales of hay, a few of them are still around, and there's a farm in Jay. That's where that came from.
Talk about everything evokes memories, doesn't it? And that evokes many memories for me.
I love this kind of a bale of hay.
J and the J, the J and J, huh?
Yeah, J and J. Little J down there. That's a Vermont scene up there. Over there by, that's Addison, before they built the big building that I left out.
Don't you love it? Once again, why else looking at
the one that was in the Book of Joe, I still have it.
Oh yeah,
in the original.
That's a classic.
In the gallery.
That's a classic.
And this is the stream that goes into Marcy Lake up in the mountains. And I guess we better talk about this one here.
You know, this is incredible. If this doesn't,
is gonna be a little.
Don't you wish the camera could capture the 3D?
Yeah.
Huh? Talk about it.
This is interesting. It's about the same time I developed the window idea. And I decided that I would try to do a something subject like this with a hinge or a window or something and raise it out with oil. I didn't do it with the stuff that dries hard.
Yeah.
I did it with oil so I could sculpture it. It takes about
you
a month.
You are amazing.
It takes a month. This
people
I don't
have
know
no
anybody,
idea how hard this is.
I don't know how many people. I don't know of anybody in the country doing this. And that my printer, the guy that used to print my work, he never printed it because he couldn't get the 3D.
Of course not.
And so he decided he'd never do it. But what happened is I layer the oil on for about a month and a half. 4 hours about every other day.
That's unbelievable. About what it
takes. And it's white at the end of a month and a half. And then you let it dry for about a week. And then I take sculpturing tools and literally sculpture it, add the bolts, add the nails, take away the holes, make the you know, the grooves and all that. The chain was the hardest thing on this painting.
Was it really?
Oh yeah, it was the hardest thing to do. I had to build it up and make it right. When I built it up originally, it was very rough. And I had to sculpture and make it.
This is the only one of this kind you've done?
I've done 29 in, it's about 40 years now.
29?
29.
You have done 29?
I've done 29. I used to, I'd sell one and then take about 6 months to get my courage up to do another.
Oh, it takes so long. It's absolutely
It takes a long time.
Amazing.
And they're hard. They're not easy.
And people would say, that's not hard to do. You just take a little barn wood and get an old hinge and screw it on there.
Yeah.
And,
you know. Well, I've had, what was that actor's name? Wanted to buy one of these, and the guy told him it was a collage. Oh, I've forgotten his name. Some famous actor, and I've forgotten his name. It was in an art show down in New York. I was in the American Artists Professional League show for 3 years. Then I got, the travel was too much. But anyway, the last show, I had one of the raised ones in it. And he loved it. But the guy that was running the show walked up to him and said, well, you know, that's a collage, you know. He's put a hinge on there. He touched it up and stuff like that. And when I heard that...
Can you imagine...
The only good part about it is I probably would have been famous by now. if he would have bought it, because he was a famous movie actor, and I've forgotten his name now. Isn't that something? But gray hair. But anyway, he wanted to buy that, but then we found out it was a collage, quote, he didn't buy it. And I've thought about it a few times in the last few years, and I thought, well, why didn't I call the guy up or get in touch with him somehow? But I never did. I just let it go.
I would. Pride would make me do that. That's for sure. It's beautiful, Bruce. I like that.
This was the one I did for the book. I did this for the book, and I wanted horses in it. I love to paint horses. I don't do a lot of them, but I like to do them, and I wanted that. That's Algonquin in the background, and that's Little Joe. The one in the foreground.
Yep.
And his friend, Al Coughlin.
That's great. Great stuff.
This is from Al's head lookout down by Elizabethtown, on the way to Elizabethtown from here. Interesting view that not many people see.
Yep.
I'm on the wrong side. Right?
That's all right. I got you.
And my son and I went up there about a year and a half. I guess it was two falls ago. And I loved it. It's Giant and Dix and Hurricane over there. There's East Corinth. I painted that a few times. Great little town. This is the greatest place in the world, Adirondacks, scenery-wise. The second greatest, in my opinion, is Orange County, Vermont. I love it. I love it. I've been over there all four seasons. I've painted all four seasons, different things. Corinth, I've done this in fall and winter and spring. East Corinth's great. This is this is a bit different.
I would say.
I found a log. I supplement my heating with wood. Yeah. I love it because it's more human. A log. Can you imagine? I cut through that log and I says, oh, I gotta say that.
Yes.
You know? and so I cut 1-inch pieces, got the idea to put flowers and a little butterfly in the one. something different.
Very, very
I
nice.
Mean, we're always reaching
Is
out.
Is that a long time ago? Did you do that?
No, it's, I think it was about 2 years ago. Oh. Yeah, about 2 years ago.
Great idea.
That's another Vermont scene over by Bethel. This is a very recent painting. Next to the last painting I painted. In fact, it was before the train station. The dock in Essex, dockhouse, famous old place. I painted that about three times way back in the days, three different seasons. And I got the idea of a sunrise one day. I just got the bug. And thought, boy, when a great sunrise, or, and I took some pictures of Dockhouse recently, and I thought, man, why not?
I love it. It's really vibrant. It's beautiful.
It's one of my favorite morning or
great
evening
colors.
Things.
Great colors. Wonderful.
This is Vermont from, New York from Vermont. Coming home from, I know. I was coming home to have that printed.
Oh, really?
I took it to Outfit and Kennebunk. I've forgotten their name. I had that painting over there.
That's the original.
That's the original. And I had it put in a giclée because a lady wanted it full size. So I had two of them done. And a lady up in Lake Placid has it in her shop now. And she wanted it full size.
Now, is this on the same kind of canvas as that original?
Basically, but this is a little heavier canvas. What I paint on is a little heavier. It's the same thing. Yeah. Say it's textured canvas. And I did a favor for her. She wanted it a little bit more rose color. You can see the difference?
I can. So that was on purpose.
It was on purpose. I could have had it just like that. And I could have had them switch it to that, but it would have cost me considerably more to switch it and adjust it. Yeah. So I decided, let's try the rose on the first runs. Now, the next time I run it with them, I'll go back to the original. But she wanted the big one, so yeah. I did it for her. And that's what I did.
So what is this?
They do a fantastic.
What is this nebula that you have
when
here?
When I was a little boy,
when I was
7 years old, in school, in grade school, the teacher had us make a booklet up. And all the different things we liked and did, our life and so forth and so on. And in the book, I wanted to be an astronomer when I grow up. 7 years
old. You're still looking to the stars, Bruce.
And I'm still
looking to the stars.
And I painted one about in 93. I painted one. And I had that thing in the gallery forever, until last year. And I had a collector from New Jersey. He's been buying from me for about 15 years. And he told me last year, he said, Bruce, I've been thinking about buying that for 6 years, and you still got it. I'm buying it this year. He used to buy scenes, He likes the scenes. And he says, I like that for all these years. I'm going to buy that. And it was the Saturn and its moons.
Yeah.
And comets and stuff, I made up.
Those make great posters.
And anyway, And then I decided the Hubble. Oh my God, they're reaching out there. My goodness gracious, that thing's 350. Was it 350?
350 million light years.
Oh yeah.
At least. Like I would know the difference.
Oh, 350 light years across.
Oh gosh.
And it's something like it doesn't have the distance. I got this out of a book.
Never mind, make something up. Nobody will ever know. No,
I
love it.
It's a lot of miles.
Yeah, long way.
Light years away. I mean, it's a star.
I love
it. That whole thing is a star to us.
So this is all your stuff over here?
This is all of Bruce's paintings.
Wait a minute.
Got to get to an intervention.
We got to. If not equal time, at least 38%. I love it. So this is your side of that wall, huh?
This is my side of the wall, and this end, and over here, and
such a different style, a different attitude,
exactly.
And a different
reading.
I have reading.
A lot of color in my pictures.
You love flowers.
I love color, and flowers are very colorful.
Yeah.
So I like to paint flowers, and I don't know what woman doesn't like flowers, right?
They're wonderful, and hummingbirds.
Right.
Oh my.
And these are the set of paintings that came out of the book.
We'll walk our way up here, because I love irises and gladioli and...
Yeah, those
birds
are
and I recognize these.
Yes, that's what I was just saying.
I recognize every one of these.
They came out of the book, and they're a collection that I'm just keeping for now. I'm not selling them, really. They're on display just for people to look at.
I think you ought to sell the whole collection.
Set together, probably.
I'll suggest the price, and we'll all go to Bermuda.
I hope it's a good price.
I love them.
But this picture over here is kind of fun.
Behind
it's
us?
My grandchildren, when they were little, and
look
they were
this.
Dressed just like that, just because that's the way they wanted to dress.
Of
and
course.
I thought, this is a picture I want to paint.
Oh, gosh, that's beautiful.
Now they're grown. They're grown young people now.
Okay, how about this one back here?
That's old, Bruce's.
That's yours, Bruce, with the old house. I love that one. On the sheep. Okay, how about this next one?
And that's my mother.
That is your mother from a photograph?
Yes, an old-time photograph.
From, well, I'll guess, 1927.
Oh, my gosh. I don't know, a long time ago.
It's a flapper era. Look at the hair. When was your mom born?
Let's see. Gosh, I think it was in 1912. I think her birthday was in 1912.
Maybe that was...
Get out my genealogy.
17?
Probably.
I was pretty close, wasn't I? Oh,
right.
Yeah. Okay.
And these are more flowers.
Yeah. More flowers.
More flowers.
More beautiful flowers.
Right.
Just great. Now, do you also work from photographs or from memory? Or
I work from pictures. I put them together from different photographs that I see out of magazines or slides or whatever. Whatever source that I can get that is printed.
Always watercolors?
Yes, always watercolors. I started out in oils.
Every medium has its own advantages.
Well, we all kind of settle into our own thing.
Yeah.
And I started out with oils, and I worked and worked and worked on the pictures until I just ruined them. So you can't do that with watercolors.
That's what I would do. Yeah.
So I started doing it with watercolors, and I just found that that works for me. I know that a lot of people say it's unforgiving. You know, watercolors are unforgiving, and you have to really think it out before you do anything with them. But to me, it just works better. I like it.
Hey, like I said, if you like it, that's the way to do it, and it shows that you're very, very, very good at it. I love this collection. I was kidding when I said you have to sell it all together. See, if I painted this, I would never sell it. And that's why I'm still poor.
I'm keeping it because I just have an idea that it might be something to keep in the family.
Oh, they're beautiful, the birds. My wife, wait till my wife sees this and says, oh, the birds, because we have 15 bird feeders at
oh,
our
do
house.
You?
Oh, yes, on a riverbank, you know.
How fun.
It's just absolutely incredible. What would you like to show us that you haven't showed us, Mr. Bruce? Anything else?
It's the only window set I got an original in right in the gallery right now.
No kidding. Let me get over here. I'm going to sneak by the camera real fast.
I found about five of these windows, and two of them I've sold. Just fantastic classics. Look at that window. Where are you going to find a window that with the edges? I don't know. I mean, it's weird.
Like a mortise and tendon.
Some guy had an enemy's barn or something. I can't remember, but I paid him some money for them, and I left, and I've got these five windows. I've sold one of them to my collector, and that's another one. This in here is a moon scene down by Elizabethtown, a farm down by Elizabethtown. This kind of thing I like doing with the moon, with the snow and the light on the barn or the house.
That's
and,
great.
You know,
yeah.
And there's some bears.
Oh, I like
there's
the bears.
There's the hurricane one that was in the book. And bears on the trail to
Baker. That was on the trail to Baker.
What'd you say?
Did you snap that picture?
I bet you didn't take that picture, did you?
No, I'm afraid not. I don't think I'd like to be that close to those cubs with that mother in the background.
Oh, boy.
No, I use photographs for that.
Yeah, that's great.
I don't know what I've got over here. There's down by Westport, sunset. Oh, this is kind of interesting because this is the prettiest dump in the world. Did you know that?
No, where's
that? The prettiest dump in the world is in Keene.
Oh, my.
Yeah, that's Wolfjaw's, Armstrong and Gothic's.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, you drive into the... It used to be that the garbage was piled like this, and this was behind it. Now they got that covered with grass, and they put it in trucks now. But you drive up to the dip. Now I can paint it again. Now
I wouldn't put that title underneath it called the prettiest dump in the world.
I painted it 20 years ago, and the trees were about the same level. Now they built it up so that when I painted it this time, they were in the same position. Pretty sneaky. Yeah, the prettiest dump in the world.
I love it.
I tell people that.
I love it.
That's probably why I still have it.
I love it.
Johnsbrook.
Yep.
Vermont scene with the sheep down
the
bottom.
Like the sheep. Yeah.
Another Vermont scene. Bridge, and I've forgotten where that is, and I feel bad about that.
I got a few.
This is a scene in Keene. This is on Pulsifer's land again. My logger brings my wood to
I love that shot. Oh,
and,
that's great.
This is on his land. Of course, the beaver weren't there, but the house was there.
Yeah.
And the dam was about here. And I put the beaver in it. Oh, here's an interesting thing here. This happened because of my collector. He's got, he has four now of the J Bridge, all four seasons. And when he read in the newspaper, Plattsburgh Republican, that they were putting the wood from the bridge in the dump over at in J. And he called me up and he says, Bruce, get over there and get that wood. It's called President's. And if you have something that's different,
oh yeah,
he knows a lawyer that deals with artists, and he said this is neat, you know, value.
Yeah,
that's what he liked the idea.
Yeah,
and so all of his paintings now are in this wood, and that's
is that a clever idea?
That's from the J Bridge.
Oh goodness!
Because I went over there and got enough for his four paintings, and I had enough for me. And another gentleman, I did a commission of the bridge for him, and he wanted it that way.
You got, you know, for future Antiques Roadshow, you got to have the provenance. You got to write that down.
Oh, you know that. You know that.
I got to write. I went to the J Bridge, and I went to the dump, and I.
And he's working up a letter.
But 100 years from now, somebody's got to know that.
He's making up a letter for me to sign it and all that. Yeah, I'm
sure. You'll love it. I never.
That's another little story.
Well, that's worth That's worth the whole trip up here.
You're learning a lot of things here today. Sawtooth and the Ossipee River coming from out of the lower lake.
Yep.
And with a deer running through the water. Keene Valley, that's in the book also.
Oh, I love that.
I still have the original.
Nice shot. I've taken pictures of stone arch bridges.
I love them.
And Scotland, and you name it. Everywhere I see one, I'm drawn to it, aren't you?
Yes, that's why I did it. I've done that twice. I did it from a different angle, but I've done it twice now.
What an ancient bridge-building technique, you know?
And there's a terrific grove of birches from the Marcy Lake up to Lake Avalanche Lake.
Yeah.
And that's the trail. This is a... I took this from a calendar, of all things. I don't normally do this from other people's stuff, you know, photograph, calendar. I don't normally do it. But I just loved it. I just loved this. The only problem was this tree was red. And man, you looked at that painting, you looked at the photograph.
Yeah.
And whoo!
Yeah.
All you can see is a tree. So.
You dulled it down a little bit, didn't you?
The old man made a gold tree. And so you can see this.
Yeah. Just beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, up by Potsdam.
Nice old-fashioned sugar bush, huh? The old way.
The trees and the deal. I mean, you see them all the time. But what got me was the road.
Yeah.
Almost infinity. I looked at that road.
See, artists can do that even if it's not in the picture.
I looked at that road, I said, And there was a house there, but they didn't have the sugaring shack, so I had
Yellow Brick Road.
I had to add that. But that road just got me. And then it was, you know, like it does. It thaws, you know, and then it freezes at night again. It tells a story.
Artists have different eyes from normal people. And that's a compliment.
You have to have.
Artists and writers have different eyes than normal people. Calvin has developed those different eyes because of holding that camera there for the last 23 years.
There you go.
You see things entirely differently.
Yeah.
And that's what makes individuals. And you can discuss that and I'll say, oh, yeah. But then to be able to put it in a painting, that's beautiful.
That's it. That, of course, is in the book. This painting doesn't happen to be for sale. It's, you know, it's we're going to keep it in the family. But, this is over by Jay, and the grandkids run in the woods.
I love it.
This little girl, this girl right here now is, let's see, she's 18 now, isn't she?
Was that Terry?
That's Terry.
Oh, she's older than that.
Is she 19 now?
She'll be 21 in January.
Woo! Did you sleep a year? Rip Van Winkle?
A couple of years.
It was I can't keep track.
That trip to Utica is what did it.
She's a teenager.
You drove in a time warp yesterday. That's what happened to you.
Bottom of the hill.
Oh, yeah.
Keene Valley.
Look at that.
I took the road out.
Oh, you have to. There wasn't always a road there.
But I took the road out.
There might have been some old Indian path there years ago.
This is the river, Los Sable, over there by Wilmington.
You know, I love the texture of the rock.
This is in spring, of course.
Yeah.
This is in spring.
Look at the texture of the rock.
And the water's running like that.
Yeah.
This road is, which road is that? Oh, that's Blackbrook by the Black Mountain Road. I got my chiropractor. Best chiropractor I ever had in my life.
Artists always have back problems, you know that.
Seth Rosenblum in Jay. He has a camp right near this road. And I went up there. I found out about it from somebody else that he helps out with the back. And I asked him if I could go up and take a picture from his camp. Yeah, I've sold the painting, but the print, I got to print it. But anyways, it got a great view out in the front and back of his camp. Maybe I should be telling everybody. But anyway,
no, that's great.
On the way up there, this road. I went out on my cookie again, you know?
Yeah, just
I mean, when I go for something else, sometimes I find something.
Of course you do.
You know.
That's the way it works.
This I stole from a gardening book. And then I added my favorite haunted house to it.
Of course you did.
I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's on the way to Middlebury. The thing is almost falling down, and I've got to do it again now. I mean, it is a haunted house now.
Oh, that's
the
beautiful.
The poor porch is swollen.
Oh, gosh. The Adams family would be proud to move in.
Oh, yeah, right. And so this was all trees, of course, the same. And this thing had broken down. I did a lot of different things to it.
Yeah.
But, man, the art. I love the art.
That's nice.
My favorite lake again.
Yep.
The Upper Osable in summer, of course, this time. Saranac Lake. And it's a road by Stiles Road by King. The one up above. Yeah, I've forgotten those mounds. I get confused. I don't want to say what they are because I don't know what they are. Oh, this is one I'll have forever.
Oh, Andy Warhol, where are you?
I almost sold this to an environmentalist.
Did
I'm
you
not
really?
Kidding. I don't think I'll mention his name.
Oh, especially since he didn't buy it.
And I thought he was going to buy it, but he didn't. I don't know what he was here. 79. I've had this in the gallery for a long time, and I don't doubt that I'll have it forever, and it'll be one of mine. But, you know, Boy Scout camp, when else do you find something like this? I was a scoutmaster for 15 years, and I had the guys out, and late winter, it was getting to be spring, and I was going along the lake there, wham, and I painted that almost exactly the way it was. And it's a raised one, early raised one. It isn't raised quite as much as the one over there.
Oh, I see. I can see it now.
But it's different.
My old trifocals had to work on it. Yeah, it's, I love it.
And then there's old white face with a skier.
Yep.
Got the wrong frame on it. I got to change the frame. That's another story.
You got so many wonderful things. So what, have you got a major, any major project coming up? Now that you've got the books going, you're going to be on the road trying to peddle the books.
I got a major thing, and I don't know.
You don't know whether.
I'm trying to talk about it or not.
You don't know whether you can release that secret to us?
It's not a secret, but it's.
It's not going to be built at Margaret and Court Streets in downtown Blacksburg, is it?
Hey, you know, this is interesting. Hey, you know, maybe this would be the way to do it.
I think it's perfect.
We've delayed it.
You think they ought to spell it right here?
Okay. We've delayed it.
Scoop.
The collector.
Bulletin.
The collector and I have delayed it to try to get certain things for it. He wants me to paint Keysville Front Street, the whole block.
Wow.
Some of it is burnt down, and I've got pictures of that. Where Stewart's is, was another building. IGA, I think it was. No, IGA, no. Wait a minute.
We know somebody's got all IGA. The stereopticon slides, don't we?
Okay.
Gunther Bauer. Do you know him? He's got all the stereopticon slides of the old Keysville. Hundreds and hundreds of them. We've done a complete interview with him. Gunther Bauer.
Where does he live? I'm serious.
Get hold of Ron Allen in Peru.
Yeah, call the Peru historian Ron Allen. His wife's name is Carol. I just talked to him. I'm writing a piece on cemeteries. But
don't let me forget.
Call Ron Allen. Okay? He'll set it up for you.
If you don't mind.
Can you see him twitch?
You got me going now. I'm serious. The problem is we've got the names of the stores in pretty good shape, but we know what they are. He knew what they are because he grew up there, you know. But he doesn't know the names of them. I'm sorry. He knows the names of them, but he doesn't know how the sign looked.
They got the signs. They got the wooden sidewalks. They got the.
This was in the 1800s.
In the 1800s, when these pictures were taken.
Wants it about when he was a kid, which is about 1930, 40. About in that age.
You can interpolate. You know how to do it. Andrew, why?
Well, that's
why
what I'm having to do. If this man might have some of these store signs, would I be happy.
All right. Don't forget whenever you're ready.
I didn't want to bring this secret up, but now I'm glad I did. We might just have
it. We got to put a new battery on. We'll be right back. What a whirlwind tour it's been. Calvin and I started early this morning from Plattsburgh and drove up through the most beautiful country in the world, and we've covered that. But we didn't know what the Heritage Gallery was all about. We didn't know Bruce Mitchell and Annette, but now we do.
Thank you for coming.
We'll never be the same again. You've affected my life profoundly. I love the way you write. I love the way you both paint. And I love the way you think about life in general. That's a good thing. And that's all part of your legacy.
Thank you.
We hope we've convinced you to get a website, get all these beautiful things
that's
on the website.
That's what we're going to have to do.
You know, Our Little Corner, that's the name of this program, has a certain scope around the North Country, but in Cucamonga, they never heard of us. And there are probably people in Cucamonga we never heard of, too. We like what you do. Thank you so much for inviting us into your lives, into your minds, and into your beautiful artwork. The best of everything to both of you and your families. We can't wait to hear what the next chapter is going to be. And if we can get you in a dark room in the schoolhouse looking at those old stereopticon slides in Keysville, maybe we'll see ourselves in one of those pictures from 1934.
There you go.
Thank you so much.
You're quite welcome. Thank you.
Now, people who can find you by driving here, you're right on Route 9N. I want to give people the address of your gallery. Route 9N heading toward Keene.
Right.
From Elizabethtown.
About 8 miles from Elizabethtown.
That's not hard to find.
On the corner of Hurricane and 9N.
I think they ought to know that from the first words I spoke when I looked up and said, Hurricane!
You might have said that already.
Katrina's here! I love it. And is there a phone number if people want to call you, if they're so inspired by this program and they want to buy everything in the place?
518 area, 576-2289.
No email address yet.
Not yet.
Come on, get up with
it. We will.
We're not modern, I'm afraid, but we will. We'll have to do it.
Your paintings are ageless. So
thank you, sir.
So is your poetry. Best of everything to both of you. Thank you all for watching our program. If you have as much fun watching this as we do recording it, then you're going to be giggling all the way home today. Who knows where we're going to be next time.